expired. But I think government, as a part of its plan, wants to look at the option of early retirement number of plants. So hub plant is one of them, and there has been a we are continue to follow it up with the government, but it must be noted that it has to be done on a win-win basis, right? So obviously, otherwise we are keeping up this plant, maintaining it, and we can operate it. So we have a legitimate right for the capacity payment on an annualized basis till 2027 expiry. So if there is a proposal, which can be agreed between the two parties, we'll definitely move towards it. But at this point in time, the discussions are in early phases between the government and the man.
So Kamran has answered the question for the first part. I guess what you're asking about is that if the hub plant was terminated, what would be the impact of the earnings per share? Obviously, that is premature for me to answer because it also depends on the deal that we reach with the government. But as far as I can just draw an analogy that for this year, I can just try to answer that question. The earnings per share for the base plants are around 10 to 15 rupees per share, depending on the rupee dollar parity.
Okay, we've got, what are the plans for the IP pending funds once received? Any plans for investing in future projects?
Obviously, as a company which is focused on growth, we already have, several avenues identified. As and when these funds are becoming available, I talked about the water project. That's a new domain and it is very scalable. We believe there is going to be focus on the renewables in a years. We've been working on some of them. So we will even then, as and when any other opportunity opens up, we will be looking at that as well. But I think it's a little premature when these funds actually come in. We'll have to manage how we change the, our filing as well. So we would use some of that towards it as well. So in order to be a much better organization in for future as well, geared towards the growth.
Okay, and similar to the growth project, there was a question, what was your thought behind acquiring ENI business?
So one of the thought process was that because it was just in itself a very lucrative deal, but as I said that, we've been growing, we've been diversifying within the same sector, that is electricity. We were an oil-based generating company, then we had Larede only. And then we focused on to coals. Now we are a much more diversified fuel electricity generation company. So keeping in line with our core strength of large industrial undertaking and energy sector, since we felt that this is going to open up another area for us in terms of the energy value chain. Oil and gas is definitely going to, hasn't seen the great days, but I think just like any other industry, the fortunes would change very soon. So we felt that we will be very well positioned with this acquisition when the opportunity arises to take advantage of that. So if the exploration runs up in some new area, we will be able to expand. So that was the, in general, it's a very well managed asset, a couple of them. So we felt that this is a good opportunity, entry point for Apple in oil and gas.
Okay, there are a couple of questions which have come in. So one is to share the individual CPP revenue recognized for the base Narwal and Larede for the fourth quarter for the financial year 21.
Okay.
Related to NEPRA, energy price sheet, why is there sometimes a mismatch between ETP cost published and ETP/fuel recognized on financial statements? Also, what are those adjustments being reflected in the NEPRA monthly sheet?
Well, I don't have the NEPRA sheets in front of me, so I was asking that question. They'll probably give us a call tomorrow and we can go through that. There are obviously timing differences in how the company's accounting is done and how NEPRA approves the fuel cost element. So maybe that is because of that. There should not be any large variations as far as we are concerned, because fuel cost payments determined on a monthly basis, and that is how it is accounted at the financial statements. So please call me tomorrow. We can possibly, you know, kind of having the infrastructure in front of us. As far as quarterly CPB revenues are concerned for each month, I don't have that in front of me right now. But obviously, we can provide that tomorrow. Just give us a call.
Okay, moving on to some tax-related questions. Please share the reason for increased tax amount for the G1 quarter. Is it all CPHGC related? Kindly explain.
Okay, yeah, majority of the tax that we have recognized on the financial statements is the deferred taxation on the share of profit from CPHGC. Because as we recognize more profit after the plant has come into operations, we also have to recognize the deferred taxation. This is purely an accounting treatment. There is no cash outflow for the taxation from the company. So that is the answer to that. And, you know, as I had, you know, kind of highlighted earlier in the earlier end of the briefing, that at this moment, we are at 25%, which is the law of the land. You would recall that in 2019, the government had increased the withholding tax on dividends for power policy projects from 7.5% to 25%. Over the last 2 years, we have been constantly engaging the government to reduce the taxation because, as highlighted earlier, this was a change that government had done after the investment in these projects. So this was totally unwarranted and unjustified. All the government officials, including the finance ministers, agree with our point of view. So far, the law has changed. We are also contemplating the legal, you know, some kind of legal defense, but that is under discussion with our legal counsels at the moment. At the same time, we have the situation rectified.
Apart from the balance 60% overdue payment from the government, is the future cash flow / investment needs of the company fulfilled? What is the projected short-term borrowing level post second payment from the government?
Okay, you're aware that IPPs obviously manage for you know, working capital requirements for borrowing from banks. So, and the dividends are also, you know, kind of managed from the cash proceeds that we receive from power purchaser. So it is a, you know, all of these you know, requirements for short-term working capital are interlinked. Whatever we receive from power purchaser, majority of that money is spent on the fuel procurement, as 90% or 85% of the tariff is actually fueling cost. So that is a requirement that we have to. Also have to maintain fuel inventories as per PPA, and I'm sure you're all aware that none of the IPPs were able to maintain the RFO inventories, as the RFO was, there was an import ban on the RFO, and RFO was not available in the country. So we had to get specific permission for the government for Narwhal to import a ship by our fuel supplier, Bhakri. So once all of these things are met, then obviously the board considers the dividend, that is board prerogative, how much dividend board wants to declare. I cannot comment on the future short-term working capital needs, but please keep in mind that since we are a regulated business, we have to maintain the working capital lines as allowed by PPIB. We cannot go overboard. But having said that, we have to make sure that we have enough cash flows to service our dividends as well as secure fuel operations.
If two units of the old plant are going to be converted as water desalination plant, then how much management is confident on government's ability for water transportation and bill recovery, as it might end up in another circular debt-like situation?
So as we talked about that, you know, we have to look at any proposal post this carve out or early retirement in terms of the commercial decision making, right? So we are in of this challenge. We would when these discussions pursue, we will have to look at the government's ability or direct sale or whatever it is. But it is de-linked to it. So whenever the government moves towards the early retirement, the options are going to be evaluated individually on merit. That's why when I talked about that we are focusing on to a D2B sale, which is a wastewater treatment, we feel that B2B aspect more as we go forward rather than B2G, which is the current differentiation in terms of our power plants. The power purchaser is our only buyer of electricity. So we would like to take on the opportunities which help us move away from the government element as much as possible.
Update on Narowal plant receivables and receivable recovery ratio of CTCG.
I'll answer the first part. It is basically just as we've been engaged with the government since last year, and we are continuously trying to push for it. But one must recognize the challenges the current government puts on to the government servants as well. So they've had reservations which we've tried our best to address from our side. We made them offer whatever, like in terms of facilitating any other arrangement they want to look at. But I think we're very hopeful that in the coming weeks and months, this issue will be resolved. So there will be change in the end. We are continuously told that there is no change in the government's commitment to make these payments and clear the dues. But as all of you might have followed the news, that there are some reservations which are in the process of being addressed by all the relevant stakeholders. Hopefully, we will be able to address these, and the payments will flow through.
Are we disconnected? Okay. On I think the question was that what is the recovery for the CPGC in terms of percentage? It is around 70%. It varies from month to month. But since COD, 70% of the billing that they have done.
Okay, update on Thar Energy and Thar Nova project status and on the water project, development of SIND and DHA.
So I mentioned that we remain committed to complete projects by Q1 and Q2, respectively, Tel Q1 and Thar Nova in Q2. Obviously, as we move from first wave to second, now the fourth wave is there. There are challenges which remain, and it's every day is brings a new set of challenges to overcome. We are committed onto that. On the water projects, I think we are more confident about the TB1 wastewater recycling, DHA cogen, and the DHA 5 MGD project. They are slightly behind, but we will definitely keep focusing on to that. I think it is, if I will define the water project, the first step will be the most important one, and our focus remains to take one of the projects to towards completion before we focus on others as well. And I think all of other projects will also line up as soon as first one is progressing well and moves towards the financial flow. So that's what our focus is. We are keeping an eye on both of all these opportunities, not only in Karachi but otherwise. But I think the most promising one is the wastewater treatment project.
Please suggest the India's expectation of prime.
Well, there are still things that need to be worked out since the project conditions precedence has not been achieved. We will have to, get back to you on that. Once that is achieved and the timing of cutoff, that needs to be determined with the ENI, sponsors from which we have bought these projects. So once these things are sorted out, we'll be able to give you a clear picture on that.
I think we'll wait until the deal is consummated because there are still some regulatory approvals, and until that happens, we would avoid any speculation on that front. So in a few months, we will get back to you with a more definitive answer as well.
Your production capacity is there, but grid stations are not very ready to take in the additional production. Is government planning to improve the grids?
I think there have been multiple upgradations, notably the 4,000 megawatt, 660 kV high voltage line from Mandavi to Lahore, which is addressing a lot of south to north capacity constraint on the transmission line. And I think as we witness in our Narowal plant and other places, that even the distribution companies are upgrading several grids. So it's a countrywide challenge that they are dealing with. And hopefully, I think there is a very aggressive transmission upgradation plan to hopefully address a lot of those constraints in the load centers. As far as our plants are concerned, we are all we don't feel face any constraints from any of our plants. Even if there is any which comes up as a seasonality or any temporary challenges that we face, but these are normal course of business in this field anyway.
Please confirm applicability of new tariff to come after receiving the first installment.
So there were two elements that were agreed with the government in February 2020 with the PPA. So yes, 40% installment. You would recall that we had agreed that going forward, dollar indexation is continued on the return on equity element or PC element as it is called in HUB. But that would now only take place when the rate reaches 168. Till then, we are continuing with the TPA indexation mechanism. The current rate is lower than 168. The other aspect was that we had given them a reduction in the fixed O&M that has been implemented after the first 40% payment.
The company's plans are engaged in 25% tax rate on coal plants in budget. What is the company's stance on no change in 25%?
So as Nasir answered earlier as well, that this are continuing. We were given a lot of assurances that this will be reversed. And now with the CPEC challenges, there are a lot of CPEC challenges. So this is one of the agenda items for resolution between the Pakistani side and the Chinese side. So we are quite hopeful that this will be reviewed. But it is very hard to give any timeline, and as Nasir earlier indicated, that we are looking at the legal options as well. So we have to keep all these options and work towards the resolution of this. So at this point in time, this is in force, but we are making our best effort to get it revised as soon as possible, either through our legal option or through engagement with the government and the stakeholders.
Also, with this question, also, will there be a retrospective impact on some decline in rates?
Yeah, the rates are actually successful in getting the rates reversed. Obviously, at this moment, we are recognizing the 20% tax and share profit, so that will be revised accordingly.
CP agency COD adjusted tariff notification date.
So it is, as you all may be familiar, the true-up process takes a while. So it is in final stages, as we understand from the CPSC management. There are a lot of things that they have to refile over, like, the true-up team asks a lot of questions and everything. That's a regular procedure for everything that they've done for Sahiwal, for Port Qasim, coal power plant. So I think we are hopeful that it'll be done in the coming weeks. So that's what we have given an indication that everything has been complete, all the reviews and everything. So they've presented it to their authority. So we are waiting for the final outcome. So it could take a few weeks.
When can we expect dividends from CPHGC, and what are CPHGC's cumulative receivables and top line numbers of the fourth quarter?
Okay, as far as the dividend timing is concerned, we are trying to target a dividend declaration during this fiscal year, December 2021 by March 2022. There are a few things that we need to sort out, as we just talked about the 25% withholding tax on dividends. Obviously, we want this issue to be addressed before we start declaring dividend from CPLGC. At the moment, their current receivables are around, overdues are around 50 million rupees.
As you mentioned, transformation outage of CPSGC, can you please elaborate if there will be any financial impact? Also, are you going to receive capacity payments? If yes, what can be the financial impact?
This event is covered under the company's insurance policies, both for material damages as well as business interruption. So the impact, as far as we can tell you for right now, because this is being assessed by the insurance companies at the moment, But the impacts will be in the form of deductibles under both the policies, both for material damages as well as business interruption.
Any chance of base plant conversion coal agreement with
Kelly? So, as I said earlier, these are the discussions which were post early retirement of the project. So we are not linking it. We are continuing to have a discussion with the possible reuse, repurposing of the site or the units. But I think these are all contingent upon the discussion with the government. So in order to get the best out of our discussion with the government, we don't want to, go too far down the other project timelines as well. But we are actively evaluating whatever is the best use for this plant in case of the early retirement of the car park.
CPHDC faced a lightning strike caused in July. What is the status of the plant right now?
So Unit 1 is out, as we talked about, but Unit 2, inspections, when such an event happens, you want to make sure that the entire plant or both units are inspected, which were, as a prudent utility procedure, you would do it. It returned to service after a few days, and it has been at full load since then, and work is progressing. So, so they are dispatching 600 megawatts ever since they came back to service.
What caused the hike in other income, on call and special?
Okay, in the unconsolidated set, obviously there is a service agreement under which a power company provides services to the limited as well as Thalnova Limited. So that is the other income. In the consolidated, we have subsidiaries that is also there.
There are also news that government is in the process to renegotiate power producers. Does HUPCO foresee any upcoming changes having negative impact on earnings?
I think government has concluded this. So there's no any further discussion, or I think the committee stands dissolved as we understand. So there is no further development in this year.
And how much project financing has been deployed for TEL and TN?
The project financing arrangements are for the debt portion, obviously, are arranged by the project companies themselves. For the equity portion, which HUPCO has to deploy, or HUP Power Holdings Limited, which is our 100% subsidiary, has to deploy, as we have already arranged all the financing that is there with us. We only have to draw down on the loan. The remaining equity commitments are around $40 million for both projects.
Is HUPCO planning hiring as Larry Group is already in hiring?
We as a growth company, we keep evaluating. If there is any good opportunity, we will definitely look at it. But at this point in time, there is no active project, we would say. But we can never rule that opportunity out. So not in the very near future, but we keep actively evaluating projects which come across. We'll continue to do that as well.
Can the management share the monthly accumulation in receivables, plant sales, including CPA?
Monthly accumulation. We can have a detailed conference call tomorrow, I guess, whoever is interested, because these numbers are readily available, I guess, from various sources. What I can tell you right now is that at the moment, HUP plants overdues are around 70 billion for Norova, it is around 18 billion for Lare, 6 billion, and CPHGC, as you said earlier, around 48, 49 billion.
I think it's a seasonality as well, so there's no one monthly rate, so I guess there are a lot of information available which you can look at, but given that the Pakistan goes through seasonality, it varies on how the cities, how the tariffs and all these things, so I don't think there is.
How did the EBITDA change in unconsolidated accounts? We had 8 billion under EBITDA change in unconsolidated accounts. We had 5 billion. Any losses in Narobal / Lare?
No, the major variation in EBITDA is because the financing costs, something more. I guess other things have remained constant over the years.
What is the company doing to improve its cash flows?
We are doing everything that we can. I guess, you know, we have already, you know, agreed with the government vision in the agreement. Whatever concessions IPPs could provide as an industry, they have agreed with the government. And you know the debacle that happened over the last 2 years in which IPPs, kind of targeted in media and whatever not. But having said that, one of the plants under the 2002 policy remains under investigation by NAB, because of which other IPPs are also suffering. So we have given, as Kamran alluded earlier, we have given various options to the government, just to adjust the excess profit from the first payment or second payment. We have told them that we are with you in a long-term relationship. The PPAs are not going away. The plants are not going away. Everything is in Pakistan. So you can adjust these amounts whenever you like. But after the due process of law has been followed, an arbitrary adjustment on an arbitrary report that was never, discussed with IPPs, who just were reached, and then, the hype was created and whatever not. We are all aware of that. And the negative follow-up effects on the foreign investment that Pakistan expects need from foreign investors. So all of these things are interlinked. We have talked about it in the past. We are constantly engaged with the government, and we are trying to resolve these crises or the accumulation of circular debt as much as possible. But IPPs can only play their part, right? The other part is the government itself.
They have a commitment, or the government has given a commitment to clear receivable until November 30th, 2020, which is going to be cash flows. And as I said earlier, the vibes from that side are very, very positive. But now being cautious that this has been so late, until unless something actually happens, we cannot. But all the messages out of Islamabad or the news out of Islamabad over the last few weeks has been a lot more positive than what, let's say, about a month or 2 months ago. But until it is documented and published, we can't say much about that part. But we are hopeful that this issue is resolved. In this year, for both 2 and 94, so the payments will become more regular.
The CPI agency considering to switch from its coal to local coal?
I think it is an exercise that the government wants to do, but I having worked in Tharcoal earlier from the feasibility days, there's only a small percentage that you can use that is not more than 20%. And then that the China Power Hub has its own jetty and imports its own, directly imports the coal to its own jetty. So I think in terms of the EPP portion, because the CPP does not change. And there will be 100% use of local coal. There will be some technological adjustment and capital expenditure, which would defeat the purpose of switching. But I think all these projects have given a commitment. They will evaluate it whatever, without any capital expenditure, whatever maximum they can utilize, they will utilize. But we must remember that the third coal has to be transported almost 500 kilometers across land as well. So that's going to be a new transportation cost. So it's not, in my personal opinion, it's not a very viable option. It might be for us, but not for China Power or the imported coal. Those which have their own import arrangement in terms of the birds.
How much penal income did
Hubco
during the fourth quarter?
Well, in the fourth quarter, we paid them around 7 billion rupees. You would recall that when we received first tranche of 40% in the first week of June, some of that amount was obviously allocated by CPPG in late net interest income, which is the penal income that you are referring to. And we also paid a proportional share to GSO in the head of penal interest, which is around 7.5 billion rupees.
Management's view on CTBCM implications related to timeline.
So I think there are a lot of challenges, but things are progressing towards the market. I think government does realize that this power sector challenges can be overcome if they were to implement this merchant market model. Nonetheless, there are some of the key decisions that they have to make the discourse financially viable for people to have a counterpart, to take a counterparty exposure. But in the long run, I'm a firm believer. I started my career in energy in Europe, and the merchant market, I believe that that is the way forward. So next year, some of the discourse are going to lose their exclusivity, which has stopped sales of renewable energy to the industrial units. But the timeline will not be as, close as being indicated by the government. On a realistic basis, I see about 5 years in the implementation from start to an implementation. There will be early pains as well as the challenges, but we are looking forward to it as an entity as well. We believe it's going to open up opportunities for an entity like Hubco, which has a diversified product experience. So, but the timelines, in my opinion, will be beyond 25, not 2022.
Are you hopeful to receive the PKR 65 billion anytime soon from June for going the future 260 billion rupees for the hub lines?
I'll be based on all cash basis, but I mean, you know, it's a side level.
Well, I mean, you know, in terms of receiving money, when the government pays us, but remember, no deal has been reached yet. Because the deal has to be, you know, kind of concluded between the parties, and it could be subject to various approvals. So, yeah, you know, we would be happy to receive it. But
so I'll just add to it that, you know, it's not a Hubco thing. So, as we talked about this PPBCM, we can say it as an early retirement policy that the government will have to, because there will be a number of other projects after Hubco. Hubco happens to be in that league with precedence. May that be base plant, may that be Lare, may that be projects. And we believe this is an opportunity and create a win-win to the government and other IPPs, which will follow suit in the years to come as well. Because as our generation exchanges, as overall some plants get closer to their end of life or end of PPA, they might want to opt it early. So I think there is a lot more done, not one plant termination or early retirement, but it has to be part three. And it has to be a win, create a win with IPPs and government. So there's a lot of work that we believe there's a lot of work to be done as well. But we are actively engaged in there should be sort of an early retirement policy to come as well, because it's going to act as a rule.
What's the update of Sindh Agro Coal Mining Block 2?
So it is progressing as per plan. So the coal will be available, as I said, from the phase 2 to 1 for Tel and for and they are for the schedules. They're progressing as per the schedule.
Apart from major investments in local coal-based power generation, what other projects are you might
have? We've talked about two which there are, but then we were working, I think, because of the Islamabad High Court on the V regulation. I think we were working on a B2B sales of a renewable energy, which was scalable to 500 megawatts, which had to be shelved. But we continue to evaluate other opportunities in terms of the. I think once there is something concrete, given that we have been at the forefront of growth in the energy sector among our and. You can be assured that we will be working on some of those areas as well. So we are looking at the newer technologies, how the grid stability, things can be looked at, new opportunities that are opening up in the rest of the developing world as well. We are actively evaluating.
Will Tel and TN be paying at least on delays in ARCOL NTPC? What impact would this have on timings and profitability?
There are some exposures in terms of LD because the projects were not able to achieve the commercial operation March 31st, 2021. We are targeting to close these by first quarter 2022 and second quarter of 2022, Tel and Talnova respectively. As far as the exposure is concerned, there are HVDC line LD. PPL lease. On both of these, we are in constant dialogue with the government of Pakistan and other stakeholders in Islamabad, because most of these delays were not directly related to the company itself, or the all were under the management's control. We could not do anything about it. There were delays under the government. Initially, you would recall that we had highlighted that there were delays in disbursement because of the higher circular debt for the CPEC projects, which were commissioned in 2018 and 19. These lenders were actually considering to pull out from these projects because they said that the government of Pakistan is not able to honor its commitments on the CPEC, which were delivered in 2018 and 19. Then the whole world was hit with corona pandemic, and there were considerable in terms of closing certain conditions precedents for the project documents, because of which the disbursements were delayed. Similarly, pandemic also caused a serious curtailment of the workforce which was required on the project site. We are trying to these challenges still remain. Financial close have been achieved and disbursements have taken place in the last few months for both of these projects. But we are still struggling to ramp up the Chinese workforce, which is required on these project sites, because there are regulations by the Chinese government itself. And if there is even a case of one coronavirus at our site, then obviously we also come to the Chinese and the Pakistani workforce. So all of this, we obviously keep discussing with these stakeholders in Islamabad, Lahore, and Ministry of Energy. And we are hopeful that, try to contain the LDs exposure to a minimum.
One of the things I'll just add, that the transmission service charge is on a proposed basis, and it's not, it's still to be estimated, because we believe there is enough generation capacity to be moved from south to north. So it's unutilized. So I don't think, if it is utilized appropriately, there will be, but it remains to be seen what the mechanism develop between NTC and CDPA on the undue capacity charges. So that is that exposure could be negligible or could be up to our capacity. So it's still uncertain because there doesn't exist a mechanism. On the BBA, as Nasser explained, that there have been challenges. It's been on both sides and all projects. So there is a compassionate view that the government might eventually take to the delays as well, because there is a capacity excess in the corona times as well, and they were staggering of some of the projects in the Heidel domain as well. So there are discussions that we are actually having. So once we know the quantum of it, we will definitely update all of you on that.
Is China exempt from corporate income tax? Why is the company book tax in its consolidated books?
Yeah, the income from power generation is exempt, and all the IPPs, including China Power, company is exempt from income tax. The income tax that took in our consolidated financial statements referred to the withholding tax that we will receive from China Power generation company. Under the accounting standards, since we book shares of profit from our associates, which is China Power generation company, it is required that we also record the deferred taxation portion on these dividends, which will be received subsequently from China Power Generation Company. And that is a deferred taxation. There is no cash flow impact as far as this taxation is concerned.
Has Hume made all the equity injections in the same coal projects? Can an improvement in layouts be expected in the second tranche?
The second tranche, though, that, that relates to the hub power companies. As far as dividends from Sindh Agro Coal Mining companies are concerned, we are hopeful that they will be able to declare some dividend during this fiscal year before June 2022. But please keep it in mind, our portion of equity investment in Sindh Agro Coal Mining company is slower. Dividend size would also be not really very, very large.
Is the working capital situation expected to improve after commencement of TEL and TEN?
Working capital situation is, and working capital activities are managed by each company itself, so there won't be any impact on capital in Hub, Narwhal, and Larit, because these are separate entities, telling them now they have to make their own arrangements for working capital. However, once we start receiving dividends from these companies, then there will be some improvement in our cash flows, but that after the COD is achieved in the year 2022.
What is the company trying to do with AIBs and Sukuk's part of overdue receivable settlement?
The PIBs and Sukuk received in the loan as part of 40% settlement. Drop in the market, we sold them immediately. We are not in the business of keeping those PIBs as well as Sukuk, and plus there are income tax implications if we held them for a longer period. And our primary focus was to create liquidity for the company, which we were able to do immediately after closing of this PIB.
What is the status of PTR 10 to first fill of plant? Have you received a 40% installment after deduction?
Yeah, dispute related to first fill is of 5 billion, and that is not included in the reconciled overdue balances CPPAG. So that amount is considered in the first 40% payment. Company will only receive it once we receive a favorable outcome of the expert arbitration that we are pursuing with CPPAG as part of our negotiations that we arrived in February 2021.
Just to get an idea for future dividend, what has the board considered while announcing the final dividend of 5 per share?
Well, come on, you're going
to cry. No, go ahead.
Well, I mean, again, like I said earlier, dividend is a function of cash flows, and a firm believer that we need to create shareholders. This was obviously pick at the board, but since our shareholders are there, we need to declare some dividends for the shareholders. So you would recall that when financial close for Shell and Salnova, that we also declared interim dividends. This dividend is mainly derived from the first 40% payment that was received by us in June. Firstly, we paid, the amount was around 23 billion rupees, we paid 17.5 billion rupees. So there was some cushion created in the amount of 5.5 billion rupees in our working capital lines. So we look at holistic picture for the company in terms of fuel procurement, in terms of further working capital requirements, in terms of having lines from the banks, and then we decide on a dividend appropriate for the shareholders, keeping in view that we have to make sure we have some cushion available for at least next 1 year to ensure that we are able to meet all the commitments for instruments as well as financial commitments that we have financial institutions and banks.
I'll just add that the IPPs actually, when they agreed to the settlement, was also with the view in mind that a lot of receivables were stuck. But shareholders' approval and everything was given for this kind of negotiation, which was outside the contract, was with the view that they'll create a liquidity and an individual company basis. And we remain hopeful that the overall in the sector would improve after these settlements as well. So, as Nasir pointed that out, that there are multiple factors. The sustainability of operations is the primary focus. And whenever an opportunity is or there is an ending available, we look at that and decide on.
Other questions which have already been answered on different projects, etc.
Maybe ask two questions.
So I think this, the last one is, EPS is only expected to grow in a couple of years. Can we see same reflected in dividends like this year?
The growth of EPS happens because a project achieves commercial operation date, like we have seen this year that China Power Upstream Company since achieved COD in August 2019. You have seen exponential growth in the EPS. But please bear in mind that China Power Upstream Company has not declared any dividends so far, so we have not seen any cash from that perspective. it takes considerable challenge for a project to declare dividend after COD, and especially when there are foreign lenders, and especially more when there are Chinese lenders.